Hi friends, today let's go through the works of the great Indian novelist Anita Desai. Anita Desai, her original name Anita Mazumdar, English language Indian novelist and author of children's books, who excel in evoking character and mood through visual images ranging from the meteorologic to the botanical. Born to a German mother and a Bengali father, Desai grew up speaking German, Hindi and English. She received Sahitya Academy Award in 1978 for her novel Fire on the Mountain. Three books of Anita Desai have been shortlisted for the Booker Prize: Clear Light of the Day, In Custody and Fasting Feasting. She won the British Guardian Prize for The Village by the Sea, and also she won Padma Bhushan in 2014. Her major works include Cry the Peacock, Voices in the City, Bye Bye Blackbird, The Peacock Garden, Where Shall We Go This Summer, Cat on a Houseboat, Far on the Mountain, Games at Twilight, Clear Light of the Day, Village by the Sea, In Custody, Bachmann's Bombay, Journey to Ithaca, Fasting Feasting, The Zigzag Way, The Artist of Disappearance. She examined the nature of pilgrimage to India in her Journey to Ithaca in 1995. Now let's go through the work Cry the Peacock, which was written in 1963. Anita Desai's Cry the Peacock has been considered as a first step in the direction of psychological fiction in Indian writing in English. Maya is the protagonist and Gautama is her husband. Maya was grown up with love and care of her parents and soon married to Gautama, but the marriage was not fruitful and she turned into being insane. Now for another work, Voices of the City, which was written in 1965. It's a story of three siblings, Amla, Nirodh and Monisha, and the ways of life in Kolkata. For another work, Bye Bye Blackbird, which was written in 1971. The background of the story is set in England, and the novel clearly explores the feelings and sufferings of the Indians at that place. This book, Bye Bye Blackbird, is divided into three parts: Arrival, Discovery and Recognition, and Departure. Blackbird used in the title is none other than the immigrant whom London says goodbye. Desai highlights the physical and psychological problems of Indian immigrants and explores the adjustment difficulties that they face in England. It explores the lives of the outsiders seeking to forge a new identity in an alien society. Now for another work, Fire on the Mountain, 1977. The story sets at the backdrop of the Simla Hills. Nanda Cole, an elderly lady, decides to live a secluded life in Karignano in Kaushali. She spends all her life in the care of others, her three daughters and her husband. She never gets time to feel for herself. Her own choice, her own will, was gone somewhere. One day, Nanda receives a letter from her daughter, Asha, asking her to take care of her great-granddaughter, Raka. A feeling of anger, disappointment and loathing arises in her. She is just not bothered about the worldly matters. Raka comes in Nanda's life and things start changing in different way. And the next work, The Zigzag Way, which was written in 2004. It's a novel about an American academic and writer who goes with his girlfriend to Mexico and rediscovers his passion for fiction writing. Next, let's go through another work, Fasting Feasting, which was written in 1999. It was shortlisted for the Booker Prize for fiction, and the novel is in two parts. The first part is set in India and is focused on the life of Uma, who is the overworked daughter of her parents. Finally, she is made to leave school and serve her parents. The story focuses on the life of the unmarried and main character, Uma, a spinster, the family's older daughter, with Arun, the boy and baby of the family. Ramubai, a traveling bone warrior, who tries to show Uma a good time, he is banished by her parents. Meera Masi tells Uma all the tales of Krishna and takes her to the ashram, allowing her to escape her mother's domination for a time. Uma's parents attempt to marry her off on two occasions. On the first occasion, the chosen man fell for Uma's younger sister Aruna. And on the second occasion, a marriage took place, but it turns out the Uma's new husband already has a wife. Uma's cousin Anamika fails to please her husband by providing children, and eventually she dies by burning. In part 2 of the same story, Aruna is introduced in America and is unable to adjust to a culture different from this town. He finds himself lost. Two cultures are explored in the text, the Indian and the American. Now let's go to another work. Where shall we go this summer? The female protagonist of the story is Sita, and she feels the frustration of the suffocating four walls is seen taking refuge from her marriage at the utopian land of a magic island. Pregnant with her fifth child, Sita therefore desperately takes refuge from the mundane realities of her marriage to the island, which happens to be homestead for her diseased father. The catastrophe of the story lies where Sita is seen perturbed with the very idea of bringing another child, as it is indeed something more than what she can handle. She physically escapes to the island and hopes to remain pregnant forever with the baby. Next, going through her another work, In Custody, which was shortlisted for the Booker Prize in 1984. The character Devan Sharma, he is a Hindi professor in Mirpur, and Murad, a friend of Devan who owns a publishing house in Delhi. And there's a famous Urdu poet, Nur, who laments the loss of the beautiful language Urdu and lived by a culture. Jane is a shop owner who gives Devan a second-hand tape recorder and sends his nephew Chintu with him to Assas. Devan earns a living by teaching Hindi literature to uninterested college students. As his true interest lies in Urdu poetry, he jumps at the chance to meet the great Urdu poet Nur. He buys a tape recorder to conduct an interview with Noor, as suggested by his friend Murad. When he meets Noor, he refuses to give an interview by saying that Urdu is now at its last stage and soon this beautiful language will not exist. Devan not only has no recording, but also has to bear the expenses like payment demanded by poet's wife, nephew of Jane, etc. That's all with In Custody. And now let's go through Bokmattin's Bombay, written in 1988. He's a Jewish boy who comes to see India. The story depicts that Bombay is seen through Bokmattin's eye. Bokmattin's Bombay opens with a lady called Lotte fleeing the scene of a murder. She just lost a close friend, Hugo Bokmattin. When she gets back home, all that is left of Bokmattin's life are a few postcards sent by his mother during the Second World War. Consequently, the story proceeds towards the life of Hugo Bokmattin. The story starts with his childhood in Berlin. At the age of about 8, his father, a Jewish furniture retailer, loses his business. The Nazis ransack his store and he is taken to a concentration camp. Baumgartner and his mother are forced to leave their beautifully furnished apartment and hide in the former office of the shop. At school, also, Baumgartner's situation becomes unbearable. His relation with friends become worse. Eventually, his arrival in Germany becomes a matter of days. His mother agrees to her Puffel's idea to send her son to India, since he has a few connections there in the furniture production business. And he makes a living in India until his Indian supporter dies. After that, at an early age, he plunges into poverty. He never gets over the death of his mother, who refused to emigrate. He is totally a passive personality whose one joy is caring for stray cats in his small apartment. Not only is he a dull protagonist, but also Desai recalls a few interesting parts of his life until towards end. The author may be investigating bigger themes by looking at the world and Indian society through the eyes of such a character. Baumgartner arouses some feelings of empathy in the whole story. The sights, sounds and smells of Calcutta and Bombay become prominent along with Hugo. These are the positive points of the story. And moving to the life of the pathetic and insignificant man, Baumgartner, who does belong neither to Hitler's Germany nor to India's society. In India, he is an eternal foreigner or a wounded survivor. And the next work, The Village by the Sea, an Indian family story. It's based on the poverty, hardships and sorrow faced by a small rural community in India. It was set in a small village called Thul in western India. Thul. The main protagonists are Leela, the eldest child who is 13 years old, and her 12-year-old brother Hari. Bela and Kamal are younger sisters. Hari and Leela have managed the family as their father was a drunkard and their mother was ill. Although their father was earning money, he used to spend it to buy alcoholic materials. Leela is left alone to take care of her family and struggles to do so. Next to their hut, there is a large country house called Manrapos, which is owned by De Silvas from Bombay, and whenever they come on holidays to Thul, Leela and Hari can earn some extra money by helping with the household or doing work in the garden. But there is a rumor in the village saying that a large fertilizer factory will replace the rice fields and the coconut groves very soon. The government chose the location for Thul for its closeness to the port of Rewas. So new highways and railway lines are to be built and the villagers are worried about their future. Hari leaves for Bombay to find work. Hari is new to the city and Jagu pities him and gives him a job to work in his restaurant. There Hari builds a strong friendship with Mr. Panwala, the lovable watch repairer of Ding Dong Watch Shop. He even gives Hari a vivid and inspiring future and teaches him watch mending. Hari realizes that he could actually make a career as a watchmaker. After some time, Hari returns to his village and shares his experiences with his sisters. They make a plan to start new business in their village with the money saved and brought by Hari. As the novel ends, the traveler highlights Hari and his sisters' resolve to adapt and change in this growing and ever-developing world. And now let's go through her most autobiographical work, Clear Light of the Day. The novel is split into four sections. The story centers on the Das family. It starts with Tara, the wife of Bakul, India's ambassador to America, greeting her sister Bimla, who is a history teacher living in Old Delhi. The conversation eventually comes to Raja, their brother who lives in Hyderabad. In part 2 of the novel, the setting switches to partition era India, when the characters are in adolescence in what is now Bhima's house. Raja is severely ill with tuberculosis and is left to Bhima's ministrations. Aunt Meera, their supposed caretaker after the death of children's often absent parents, becomes alcoholist and dies of alcoholism. Earlier, Raja's fascination with Urdu attracts attention of the family's Muslim landlord, Haider Ali, whom Raja idolizes. When he heals, Raja follows Haider Ali to Hyderabad. Tara escapes from the situation through marriage to Bakul. In part 3, Bhim, Raja and Tara are depicted in pre-partition India awaiting the birth of their brother, Baba. Raja is fascinated with poetry. He shares a close bond with Bhim, the head girl at school, although they often exclude Tara. Tara wants to be a mother, although this fact brings ridicule from Raja and Bhim, who want to be a hero and a heroine respectively. The final section returns to modern India and showcases Tara confronting Bhim over the Raja's wedding and Bhim's broken relationship with Raja. This climaxes when Bhim explodes at Baba. After her anchor fades, she comes to the conclusion that the love of the family is irreplaceable and can cover all wrongs. After Tara leaves, she decides to go to her neighbors, the Misras, for a consort, and she is touched by the unbreakable relationship they seem to have. She tells Tara to come back from the wedding with Raja and forgives him. The novel tells not just the story of the separation of a family, but also of a nation. Thank you.